So I'm talking about the ICL and various situations, troubleshooting problems, unique features, unique situations, a little collection which I've developed over time. So first of all, this is how simple. So problems would happen in the best of hands, in the most experience of people, and it is how you handle those problems. Now, the first thing that I want to tell you guys is I've switched over to putting an ICL under BSS, no visco at all, even in the cartridge, even in the interior chamber. And this is this video. The irrigation is on continuously, and that is in my left hand. The manipulator is in my right hand as I tuck the haptics in. Before I tuck, I ensure that the axis of the ICL is already matching the axis marked on the cornea. And I keep it in that axis all the while as I tuck the ICL in the eye. And supporting the ICL with my left hand with the irrigator so that the lens after the tuck opens out in the axis and doesn't move sideways. And with this, I'm able to finish off a surgery in 5 to 7 minutes. But it is not because of the speed because of which I'm doing this surgery. There are reasons for this. And the reason is that no visco means there are no visco deposits on the crystalline lens. No early post-op IOP spikes, as there is no visco occluding the trabecular meshwork. So for the past few years, for the past two and a half, 3 years since I've switched over to this technique, I'm surprised that this issue of post-op raised IOP is over. Zero incidents. Once in a while, I did try a hybrid technique. That means I thought, let me put visco in the injector only and see how it works. So if I use the visco in the injector, there were some ripples coming into the eye, and but I really didn't find any much of a difference between injecting the ICL with visco in the injector and without visco in the injector. Total surgery time was shortened, and the beauty of it was that even at 2 hours post-op, when we saw that patient in the OPD before we let that patient go, the cornea was crystal clear. Vis-a-vis, when we used to use HPMC, and HPMC used to take quite a while, almost a minute, to remove that entire HPMC from the eye, and sometimes still, there used to be some residual HPMC, which took probably another minute. And in these long periods of irrigation aspiration, the cornea lost its clarity. But then it recovered by the next day. But whatever it, I assume it is better if it doesn't lose its clarity all along. However, I don't recommend this to be done by the beginners. At least 50 ICLs experience with visco, understand the system, and then think about this. Now, here is a situation where I have removed the visco thoroughly after 1 minute of irrigation aspiration. But still, a number of you must be observing this phenomenon. The visco comes in from under the ICL, coming in from the sides, and it keeps coming out like a smokestack. Which means all that effort to remove the visco from the chamber is not necessarily complete. And this is responsible for problems. Now see this. I'm going to irrigate this out. assuming that all my visco is out. I hope I'm audible still. Hello?
You are audible. You are audible. Very well. Very
yeah. Much. Yeah. And still after that irrigation, the visco was coming out. So this is what set me thinking, why not eliminate visco altogether? So I haven't seen a post of spike in the last 1,000 ICLs inserted under hydro insertion. Now, this is one of the problems. Visco on the crystalline lens. And this used to cause a little haze because of the residual visco left after removal of all the visco. And we always thought that this visco, in case it was left behind, would go off in a week's time. But to our surprise, we have had some cases where it persisted for 6 months to 8 months. So that was another compounding reason for us to switch over. Now, when I was going around taking some classes on ICL insertion at various places, I asked people what was the major problem, and they said the loading of the ICL was a major problem. So much so that people used to say that before we used to give the side ports, we used to first take out the ICL and load it. And once we were sure it is loaded, then we used to go ahead with the surgery. So here, a little attention needs to be given to how to load the ICL. The process is very simple. After this ICL is in position here, don't touch it in the center and turn around the silicone tip applicator clockwise. It's like a gear system. You turn the silicone applicator clockwise, the ICL turns in anti-clockwise and it goes into the cartridge. So you see that? So now you'll see one single straightforward movement. Not in the center, but a little ahead of the center. So that the whole ICL turns in a straight line. Not that one portion is turning in more than the other. Here, press, turn clockwise, the ICL turns anti-clockwise into the cartridge. It is so simple. And then another thing is how you bring the ICL into the nozzle. You need to have a good full grip. Here I've had a very shallow grip. You can see that very small. And every time I miss out on pulling the ICL in, so, I'll just show you why I was unable to get a full grip. This ICL holder's mouth was not opening up fully. It should open up fully. So, it can go up till the end, hold the ICL in a larger grip, and then bring it to the nozzle. ICL opening sideways is not a very big issue. As it opens sideways, you turn the nozzle in, but you have to check this when it is about 2/3 in, and then once you think it is in the right position, you let go. ICL opening upside down is again not a very difficult situation to handle. Please detest from turning it around. All you have to do is you should have a forceps. A forceps is a good grip. Most of the people use a MacPherson, and believe me, MacPherson is not a good grip to hold the ICL and bring it out. One of these, this is IOL holding forceps. Just have a good grip and pull it out. It is very simple. Iris can prolapse. Once you are doing an irrigation aspiration, after the ICL is in position, you have to remember that the AC has become shallow. The AC has become shallow, so the moment you come out of the chamber, the iris could tend to follow you and prolapse in the incision. So this is where you really need a carbocol or pilocarpine. Just a little squirt and the iris will come into position. Now, here is another point that you need to remember here is how to avoid this iris from coming into the incision. The RS comes into the incision when you're irrigating, and as you're irrigating, you're pulling out of your irrigators. So along with the fluid comes out the RS. Now, the control is that when you are irrigating, you stop the irrigation. Once you stop the irrigation, a little bit of fluid keeps oozing out from the side ports or the main port. The pressure of the eye drops. And when you see the cornea coming down, that is the time to slowly pull out your instruments. Then the iris does not follow. Here was a situation where somebody had operated and the ICL was upside down. And you can notice how it is upside down. There's a total peripheral posterior synecdoche. That means the foot plates are pushing the iris against the cornea, and the optics was hitting the crystalline lens. We bought this out. We really could not break all those synecdoche because those synecdoche were there for so many years. The patient was going from one doctor to another doctor for glaucoma management. We used the same ICL and placed it in the right position. And what is surprising was that even after 4 years, the patient had not developed any cataract in this case. That was a very interesting finding. ICL in hyperopes, the main thing you need to know is that the ICL does not come with a central hole, so you need to make two PIs. Yark PIs are very painful, very disturbing. The patient is very discouraged. So vitrectomy PIs work well, provided you don't make this kind of a mistake that you continue aspirating and cutting and land up in a very large PI. Piggyback ICL, we did try in a couple of cases. More for the sake of trying, because the Sulcoflex was also available and at a much lesser cost. But these lenses worked very well as a piggyback IO. This patient is still doing very well. Okay.
I think you can continue, sir. We have time. Gaurav is in another talk. You can please continue.
Okay. So we, whenever we talk about the phakic IUL and ICL, the first thing that comes to the mind is cataract. That is the thing that every beginner is afraid of. Why should I enter into this trouble zone? Because you can have a cataract, you can have a glaucoma. So our experience with cataract was that as long as we were using ICL without the central hole, there was some incidence of cataract, about 0.4%. And the cataract was usually anterior subcapsular cataract. Here you can see the in the left picture, the ICL with a very poor wall, and in the superior area, there's a little touch. On dilation of the same eye, you can see the entire profile of the ICL, and you can make out in the lower area there's a very shallow wall, and in the upper area there is a crystalline lens touch. And this patient used to visit us every year. At fifth year, we noticed that he has developed a small white spot here. On dilation, this was a clear-cut anterior subcapsular cataract. We, at that time, this was a fairly new thing for us. Nobody was very sure what should be the line of action. Probably even now, not everybody is very sure of what the line of action should be. Should we let it continue, or should we remove the ICL and place a size bigger so that you have a bigger wall? People feel that now that the cataract has set in, changing the ICL may really have no clear-cut advantage. So let the cataract progress and deal with it accordingly. That means you remove the cataract and the ICL. But this question, I will put it across to all the panelists. What should you do if you see a anterior subcapsular spot? And should you take a remedial measure to change the ICL with a higher size or let it be. Now, ever since the aqua port came in, the fluid movement across the anterior surface of the capsule was good. There was no aqueous stasis under the ICL, and so catheter development almost became a thing of the past. In our series, we haven't had a cataract for 7 years. So is the experience of a number of other people. However, I do see once in a while people presenting that they have had a cataract in the last few years. So you cannot say that nobody's ever had a cataract, but it's on individual experience of handling the lens. Glaucoma, due to a very high vault, on the right side, you see such a high vault that there's hardly any gap between the iris and the cornea. In such a situation, even though the IOP was normal, we decided that this is not a great thing to leave for ever. Let's intervene and reduce the size of the ICL and reduce the wall. We did that and it worked very well. ICL rotation, like Dr. Sonu said, that if you're using a toric, maybe you should prefer one size larger so that the ICL fits snugly into the sulcus and has a lesser tendency to rotate. However, here, this ICL, if you look at the dilated version, you see that the vault is very shallow. So if the vault is very shallow, we can assume that the size is a little smaller than what should have been ideal. So ICL rotated, and this is a standard rotation of an IUL formula, that if there is a 10 degree rotation, the lens loses 1/3 of its toricity. 20 degrees rotation, it loses 2/3 of its toricity, and 30 degrees rotation, all toric effect is lost. Now, suspect rotation. How do you suspect that this could have rotated? You probably think probably something, not my ICL power was not right and something was not correct. But you would suspect an IOL or an ICL rotation when there is an unexpected residual astigmatism. Best corrected vision will always be normal. You have not lost the quality of vision. Only that with a pinhole, the patient will be reading, or with the corrected glasses, he'll be reading normal. And you would always have a combination like this. A plus one sphere and a minus two cylinder, or a plus two sphere, a minus four cylinder. 1:2 ratio. Half sphere, one cylinder. So whenever you have this kind of a combination in an IUL or in an ICL, always suspect rotation. Here, the ICL had rotated through 60 degrees. Bringing it back is very simple. You just have to enter from the two side ports and dial it along. No big challenge. This patient, what happened? He had a cylinder of 3.5, and because of wrongly placed or because the ICL had rotated, the cylinder became 6. Because it had rotated through 30 degrees, 60 degrees. At 30 degrees, the power became 0. At 60 degrees, the power became double on the other side. So, we brought it into position, but again, it rotated. So, this happened in three cases. All the three cases, we brought it into position and they rotated again. Which made us believe that once an ICL rotates, it may be a good practice to plan exchange with a higher lens. Thank you so much, Dr. Sonu.